Good morning, and welcome to St. Joseph. We thank you all for being here this morning to celebrate Barbara's life and to gather and to send her home. Hopefully you all have the worship aid, which has all of the songs and the readings for today. And so let us begin. Let us stand as we are able and sing our opening song, Be Not Afraid.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father, and the Holy Spirit be with you. Good morning. Let me go ahead and ask you to be seated. I want to welcome you to St. Joseph's Church, and I want to offer special words of welcome to so many of you who come from a long history at St. Patrick's Church. How wonderful to see you here this morning and to join us and as we gather to celebrate our dear, dear Barbara. I want to say blessings, of course, to Paul and Henry and Nathaniel and Janet, her mom. So glad to have a chance to pray with you in this difficult time. Welcome as well to her sisters, Catherine and Michelle, and her brother Andrew. Blessings to you. This day is a day when we remember, a day when we pray. We pray in thanksgiving. We pray in honor to her and her goodness, and to God's goodness that now brings her into a fullness that we all hope to share with the saints as the saint that she was among us. She became a saint on the day she was baptized. And so, in memory of that baptism, we bless her remains with the holy waters of baptism once again. In the waters of baptism, Barbara died with Christ and rose with him in new life. Let her now share with Christ in glory. Amen. I'm going to offer a prayer, and then a wonderful person, we just call her Sister B. Sister B, she taught me how to pronounce her last name, but I don't think I can manage it, and I don't want to destroy it. But Sister B will say a few words and tell us more about the life of Barbara. Many of us knew her maybe a short time, like myself, only a little over a year, but many of you as well, small times, longer times, maybe all her life. So to give us a picture and to help our memories, Sister B will speak to us words of the life of Barbara. But first, let us pray. God Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Grant through the mystery of this sacrament and this occasion, your servant Barbara, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice and rise again through him who lives and reigns in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Sister B.
These are not my words. These are the words of Paul, Barbara's mother, Janet, and Barbara's sister, Shelley. I'm honored to be asked to share these words. And as Father Chris said, some of us knew parts of Barbara in her life. I got a whole total picture of Barbara. So, let us begin. So I would like to begin with Barbara's mother, Janet. Thank you for these inspiring words. A light hath been extinguished with the loss of my daughter, our friend Barbara. She was my firstborn and constant helper as her four siblings arrived the following years. Barb was the loving daughter everyone dreamed about. She loved going to garage and estate sales, always looking for those perfect vintage items to add to their home. There was the perfect vintage kitchen stove, the perfect vintage ceiling light for the living room, the perfect living room sofa, and so many other things, all in the 1910s to 1950s style that she loved. Barb loved with all her heart her dear husband, Paul. My Paul, she called him, because her dad's name was also Paul. She loved being a mom to her boys, Henry and Nate. She loved to travel, had so many places that she yet had to see. She and Paul invited Barbara to come along with them on a trip to Ireland, making so many memories. And there was a recent trip to Portugal, another place to check off her bucket list. And then a recent trip to San Francisco, where they once again invited me to come along for that final visit to the Crow's home, which was being put up for sale after being in the family for almost 100 years. She and Paul brought back so many family treasures that were still stored in the home. Letters written by her grandmother in a German language, some almost 100 years old, which she had just started to translate into English. Old photos, puzzles. She always had a puzzle in progress on the card table. Many family treasures that can never be replaced. She and Paul had made plans to attend a large antique show in Boston in May and had invited Barb's mother to come along so that they could visit her brother in Boston area while they went on to the antique show. And our annual Christmas shopping sprees every year in downtown Sumner, where she would always find some antique treasure to add to her collection. And our annual Christmas cookie baking day, her special turd cookies, a name we somehow came up with for the shape of the cookie. And from Barbara's sister, Shelley. Barbara was to me the very heart of our family. From our original family, she created family around her through the special people she met. First was her much-loved husband, Paul, and their children, Henry and Nate. Then was her church family and our extended families, aunts, uncles, cousins, but especially those most of us who had lost touch with ex-wives, distant family from our roots abroad, and newly found cousins. She reached out via the internet to find them and form real bonds with them. When tragedies befell us in 1999, our brother Stephen died from an accidental drug overdose, and we wanted nothing more than to fall apart. Barbara, through her strength of will, kept pulling us back to our center, to her. When she and Paul brought home their boys, I felt my heart filled with joy, just watching hers filled to overflowing. Henry and Nate, she loves you with such fierceness. I cannot wait to see it reflected in your faces when you hold your own children. She was the best mom, cheering in your victories and finding help when things went wrong. Everything she did was deliberate. I blame her alone for introducing me to real German chocolate. Barbara helped me to help teach me how to love reading. I was at the point when I was ready to give up, when she finally sat down after dinner and read to me from Where the Sidewalk Ends. Then she made me read aloud. How I hated that, until I didn't. I came to love reading so much that I became an English teacher. Many of my favorite came from borrowing her books, The Lord of the Rings Trilogy, Mary Stuart's Arthurian Legend, and the Outlander series. Barb loved music. And so did we. We grew up singing songs from the Hootenanny songbook around the campfire. Then came Billy Joel and Mannheim Steamrollers, children's songs, and singing with her church choir. Her goofy sense of humor matches all of our families. She just got me the way few other people do. Thankfully, our children have it too. It feels like home to me. Her sense of adventure was undeniable. She was fearless. In her teens, she set off with Grandma Crow's and a few years of German classes to meet all of our family living in Germany and Austria. Even though I was a shy person, the idea of traveling thrilled me. So, of course, I had to go and study in Vienna, where I followed the path she forged and met our European family with Mom and Dad. But what I loved most about Barbara was her deliberate choice to love even when it's hard. To love and serve people you don't know. To love people even when you've been hurt by them. And no one knows how to hurt us deeper than our own family. We overcame these things with her help. She is gone, and even though I will forever feel as if something has gone terribly wrong with the universe, I will continually strive to be what she was for others. And from her beloved husband, Paul. I first met Barbara at a meeting with the Chancellor Club, which was an organization of Catholic young adults. We hit it off immediately. She was still working on her master's in library science at the University of Washington. She thought about going into medicine, but her love of books led her to librarianship. She introduced me to her loving family, her parent, Janet and Paul Crows, her sister Kathy and Shelley, and brothers Stephen and Andy. They had moved to Washington from Arizona when she was very young. She then grew up in the area now known as Newcastle and graduated from Hazen High School in Renton, where she was inspired to learn the German language and played clarinet in the band, which helped form her love of music. We dated for more than a year, and Barbara was getting impatient. "Are you or are you not going to propose to me?" I was always having trouble making big decisions, and I figured I had better not blow this. We married at St. Madeline Sophia Parish on a rainy November day, surrounded by family. Mike and Collene Lynch sang at the ceremony, and Collene is here. Before we were married, we went house hunting together. Barbara loved old-fashioned houses. We settled on a rundown colonial style with a fantastic view and a Magnolia neighborhood. We immediately began fixing it up, become serious to-do-yourselfers. We later took on a major addition, copying the original architecture. We worked out every detail together, reflecting Barbara's sense of taste. We got especially creative designing the tile patterns in the bathroom. Barbara was the most perfect partner for me and my weird hobbies. She not only tolerated them, but helped expand and curate the collections. She knew that it wasn't likely to change, and neither was she. We grew to love each other for who we are. I could have never found a better partner, and every year our love grew stronger. And she was that way with everybody. If you needed love, she was there to provide love. She was amazing at remembering people. I would go to her when I couldn't remember the names of my cousins. In our early married life, we would travel whenever we could. Barbara was always eager to visit new places, so off we went to places near and far. Barbara was a lover of nature and enjoyed taking hikes, whether to Mount Rainier or along Oregon's ocean beaches, or to more exotic places like Maine or Hawaii or the island of Guadalupe. We went hiking often, occasionally taking backpacking trips. Her love of nature led her to always try to do what little thing she could to help save our planet. But more than anything, Barb longed to have children. We had not been able to have children of our own. We tried fertility treatments without success. We decided to adopt, and it took a long time to find a match. We adopted first Henry, then Nathaniel. With two boys, Barbara decided to be a full-time stay-at-home mom. She devoted herself to helping the boys to grow up well. When the boys entered school, she volunteered there whenever she could. Barbara loved good food and was an amazing cook. She loved to bake. And Paul says, "I'm sure I gained several pounds from her delicious cookies." But she made sure that I did a share of the cooking as well. There were times that I would come home from work and Barbara was at work on a recipe and it would smell just heavenly. I want to say something about the cookies. Several of us are here from Encountering God, a group who goes out on the streets to visit the unhoused, make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. But Barbara needed more than that. So we added meat, and she made homemade cookies. So the folks downtown love her cooking as well. Barbara enjoyed many hobbies. She started collecting stamps as a teenager and continued to pursue it seriously. She passed many pleasurable hours adding stamps and reorganizing her albums. Having caught the collection bug and tolerating my collection, she jumped in other collections. In addition to her first love, books, she built a large collection of Viewmaster packets, mostly of world travel subjects. Through them, she enjoyed revisiting places she had been, visiting places that she would never be able to visit. She developed an interest in vintage jigsaw puzzles, mostly from the 1930s. And her sister claimed that they were designed as some sort of torture device because the older kinds often lacked a picture and had no interlocking pieces. She assembled hundreds of them, keeping all of the best ones. There was always a puzzle partially assembled on the card table, and there's one now, half finished. To provide ideas for a remodeling project, we picked up a few old home decorating magazines, which soon turned into dozens. Barbara joined me in collecting old 16mm films, aiding and abetting me, helping haul home truckloads of old films, and watching and cataloging thousands of films. Every Saturday evening after dinner, we sat in the living room watching old films together, most of which we had no idea what they would be about. In spite of the addition to the house in Magnolia, our hobbies and children expanded to fill the available space, and Barbara began itching for more breathing room. After my work moved northward, we began a search for a house on an ideal piece of land. Barbara searched the real estate listings every day and drove around to see what they looked like. When she spotted a not-so-nice house on a big lot with two large detached garages in Lake Forest Park, it was just what we wanted. We now set out to build our dream house. Barbara scoured the old magazines and house plan books. She drove around Seattle snapping photos of houses with features she liked. Working with the designer, plans were drawn up for an authentic replica of an old house in a craftsman's style, where the antiques could be displayed. The existing house was taken down to the studs, and a second story was added. Our family spent two winters in a travel trailer on a lot until the house could be occupied again. Barbara managed the project, being on site to be sure our vision was being followed. We had contractors do most of the heavy work while Barbara and I worked on the details where we could. While living in the house, we added more interior detail using salvaged hardware wherever possible. The large front yard was a blank canvas to design a beautiful garden filled with the flowers she loved. It took a few more years to complete, but it is now beginning to really take shape. But she never reconciled herself to losing her tulips, irises, and many other plants to those drafted, adorable bunnies. A little over 15 years ago, Barbara and I had become frustrated with how our neighborhood parish was being run and came to St. Patrick, where we found our spiritual home. She was immediately welcomed into the choir, where she could express her love of singing. St. Pat provided her the opportunity to participate in the discussion groups on social and environmental issues. When Deacon Dennis, whom we met at St. Pat, started the Sacred Encounter Outreach to the Homeless, Barbara saw it as an opportunity to act on her concerns for the less fortunate. Fighting back her fears on the unknown, she went out with the group every Wednesday. On Tuesday afternoons, our kitchen became a sandwich assembly line. When we were making sandwiches, Barbara tried to pick out the better quality ingredients so we'd at least have good tasting sandwiches. And as I said, she would make the homemade cookies to give out, which were a highlight of the unhoused day. She tried to be friendly with anyone who would receive it and was amazingly good at remembering their name. She helped them feel like they were loved too. And I believe some of them are here. So welcome and thank you for allowing us to be part of your life. As we know, Barbara's greatest thrill was being able to raise her two boys. It was a roller coaster of joy and frustration. She did her best to provide meaningful activities for them and to help them to succeed. Her patience was tested by teenage rebelliousness, forcing us both to engage in some tough love. Our family is together now, happy and healthy because of her courage. About 5 years ago, Barbara was diagnosed with early stage breast cancer, which she fought for a year. With surgery and radiation, her cancer has been in remission. Barbara remained eager to travel, including places such as Ireland and Portugal. Sometimes she would need to motivate me and the boys and insist that we need to go somewhere this weekend. After major trips, Barbara would compile a scrapbook to preserve the memories of the trip. After Paul retired last year, Barbara started planning more trips. And as we know, the next one was to be in Boston. Paul says, "I love Barbara with my heart and soul. She is everything to me, Henry and Nate." So I like to conclude with three different quotes. And so Paul's quote was that he found a piece of yellow paper folded up, and this is from Thomas Merton. "Our job is to love others without stopping to inquire whether or not they are worthy. That is not our business, and in fact, it is nobody's business. What we are asked to do is to love. And this love itself will render both ourselves and our neighbor worthy." And Shelley wrote from Henry David Thoreau and Walden, "I went to the woods because I wished to live deliberately, to front only the essential facts of life, and to see if I could not learn what it had to teach, and not, when I came to die, discover that I had not lived. I did not wish to live what was not life. Living is so dear. I wanted to live deep and suck out all the marrow of life." And Barbara's mother closes with, I'm sorry, I don't see it. Give me one second. I know this has been a long eulogy, but Barb had so much to offer. Oh, here it is. So I end with Barbara's mother saying, and I think it's from all of us, "There's no way to truly express how much Barbara meant to all of us as a loving daughter, a friend, a co-worker. Our only consolation is that we will be with her again someday, along with all our loved ones. May she rest in peace." Thank you.
Thank you, Sister B. Look at you. Beautiful words that give us a picture not only of Barbara, but to know Barbara and see her, and just even this picture of her is a revealing God to us as she expressed God in her life so beautifully. So now let us contemplate the words that come to us from our scriptures. Let's first hear words from the Book of Wisdom, read for us by Lisa Dennison.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. but they are in peace. For if to others, indeed, they seemed punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, God proved them, and as sacrificial offerings, God took them to himself. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second scripture lesson comes from Paul's letter to the Corinthians and will be read for us by Michelle Craw.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. If I speak in human and angelic tongues, but do not have love, I am a resounding gong or a clashing cymbal. And if I have the gift of prophecy and comprehend all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I hand my body over so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. Love is not pompous. It is not inflated. It is not rude. It does not seek its own interests. It is not quick-tempered. It does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. If there are prophecies, they will be brought to nothing. If tongues, they will cease. If knowledge, it will be brought to nothing. For we know partially, and we prophesy partially, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I used to talk as a child, think as a child, reason as a child. When I became grown, I put aside childish things. At present, we see indistinctly as in a mirror, but then face to face. At present, I know partially, then I shall know fully, as I am fully known. So faith, hope, and love remain these three, but the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel lesson comes from the book of, and the Gospel of Matthew will be read for us by Deacon Dennis Kelly, who will also give us the homily. So let us stand and join in singing.
The Lord be with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord. There's a story told about Saint Kateri Tekakwitha, the first Native American woman declared a saint by the church, that reminds me of Barbara. Saints are everywhere. Holiness is not limited to nuns or priests or deacons. It's something that's attainable by everyone. And holiness is the first step towards sainthood. When word of Mohawk converts passing circulated through what was called then New France in the Americas in 1680, the news was a simple declaration. The saint is dead. I know I felt that way the moment I heard the news of Barbara's passing. I think maybe we all felt that way. Our holy and saint-like friend was gone way too soon. There's a deep Jesuit connection to Saint Kateri, thanks to the documentation of the missionaries who detailed her life of holiness in the 17th century. And the miracle that led to her canonization in 2012 happened right here in our own backyard, when a young Lummi Nation boy with a lethal flesh-eating bacteria was suddenly cured one day after a relic of then Blessed Kateri was laid on a pillow next to his head during a prayer service at Seattle Children's Hospital. His miracle cure could not be explained by the doctors or the nurses. Today, Jake Finkbonner is a recent college graduate with plans of becoming a doctor himself. The power of a life touched by a saint. And all of us were touched by this holy life of our friend Barbara. If you open your worship aid to the back page, you'll see a cherished picture of Barbara with one of our native friends from the streets of Seattle. Rick Williams is a well-known native woodcarver. Saint Kateri was, or I should say is, the patron saint of not only Native Americans, but also of ecology and the environment, something near and dear to Barbara's heart. I envision Saint Kateri and Barbara chatting now together in heaven, and that brings me peace. How perfect that her husband Paul chose today's gospel reading from Matthew, because Barbara lived the Beatitudes every day. It was who she was with her family, with her friends and choir mates, and with those that she met on the streets with sacred encounters. We started Sacred Encounters on Holy Week 2021. Barbara was one of the first to step forward from St. Patrick to join in the shared ministry with Christ our hope. She confided in me as she joined the team, "I'm afraid of homeless people." I told her, "You've come to the right place." Barbara knew that the poor were blessed. Jesus says so in today's gospel. It's just that some of our unhoused friends can be a little scary. What does Jesus mean by blessed in Beatitudes? What's he really saying here? The word has two meanings in Hebrew. One meaning points more to what is inward, while the other points to what comes to us from without, the outside. Eight in number, the Beatitudes paint a picture of Jesus' vision for the kingdom of heaven. Everything considered cursed or unfortunate in our human eyes becomes blessed in Jesus' eyes. Jesus turned his world and our world upside down with the Beatitudes and forces us to face our preconceived notions of things. After our very first session walking the streets of downtown Seattle, showing love to those experiencing homelessness, Barbara turned to me and said, "I'm no longer afraid." Her eyes had been opened by sharing Jesus' ministry of love on the margins. Indeed, blessed are the poor in spirit. Jesus' words fueled the cookies she baked and the sandwiches she and Paul made together for the unhoused, the miles she walked to share the ministry of presence with them, and the heart she poured out always to those who are poor and marginalized. She understood that the Beatitudes are not necessarily about the poor in spirit, the meek, those who mourn, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, the merciful, the pure of heart, the peacemakers, and those who suffer persecution in search of holiness. These are not different people or kinds of people, but they are different demands made on everyone who wants to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Christ calls each and every one of us to become living saints by living the Beatitudes, like our beloved friend, Barbara. In 1 Corinthians, we heard Jesus' law of love. St. Paul shared this with the people of Corinth to get them to change their heartless ways. At the time of the letter, there were great divisions in the Christian community in Corinth. You see, the well-heeled were treating their poorer neighbors as second-class citizens by making them sit at the back of the church and not get things before they did. Privilege guaranteed proximity to Jesus. But this is not what Jesus expects of us. And St. Paul knew it. It's why he used his letter to crack heads in a love-filled way. If ever we are scolded, don't we all want to be scolded by someone who uses love-filled words like St. Paul? And remember, the Greek word used here for love actually translates to charity. That changes the entire context of this famous passage. Charity, love, is what drove Barbara to serve on the margins. This form of love flowed from her weekly on the streets of Seattle. Barbara's sudden passage
at such a young age has left us all reeling and feeling lost. Paul, Henry, Nate, you are surrounded by hundreds of people who share in your mourning and who love and respected this amazing and humble woman. Thank you for sharing her with us. To Mother Janet, Sisters Shelley, Kathy, and Andy, know that Barbara is right now sharing quality time with Stephen in heaven, and they will be watching over you forever. And to all of Barbara's St. Pat's friends, her music and actions will ring in our hearts forever. She has now joined the choir of angels, and I can just hear that voice in heaven, and it is glorious. And to all of Barbara's Sacred Encounters friends, especially those here with us today, her spirit walks with you every time you're on the streets of this fair city, spreading the gospel of love to those on the margins. She is now watching over all of our unhoused friends. The soul of our righteous friend Barbara is in the hands of God, and no torment will ever touch her. In the eyes of the foolish, she seemed to have died, but she is at peace. Yes, my sisters and brothers, the saint is dead, but she is now alive in Jesus Christ forever.
We continue now with our prayers and with our celebration at the table of the Lord. The prayers written for us on this occasion by Jan Thomas, who will lead us in this prayer. I invite you to join us together if you are able to stand, and let us respond to the prayers.
To our loving Lord, who goes to prepare a place for us, we raise our hearts in prayer. For Barbara's husband, Paul, and her sons, Henry and Nathaniel, may the love that has been shared with them continue to sustain them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Barbara's mother, Janet, Sisters Kathy and Shelley, Brother Andy, and her extended family. May all of Barbara's family remember her strength, her integrity, her faith, and her kindness, and find comfort in her memories. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Barbara's friends and all she has touched over the years, and for St. Patrick's and St. Joseph's Parish family who have provided so much love and support. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As Barbara cared for those in need of food and shelter, may we follow her example by giving generously of our resources so that all may live in dignity. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the planet we all share, may policymakers and all of us honor and preserve our world
so that future generations are able to explore and live joyously in it as Barbara did. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Eternal God, we thank you for Barbara and for all that she means to each of us. As we too journey towards death, may we do so in the company of Jesus, who came to share our life, that we might share life eternal. In the name of Jesus, our love and our life.
Amen. Thank you, Jan. We'll continue now to prepare our altar for our Eucharistic sacrifice. Our guest will be brought forward to us by Kathy and Alan Filipowitz. I invite you to be seated and join in the singing, if you will. I invite you to stand, and as I pray the long words of our prayer, pray them in your heart. First, let us pray, sisters and brothers, that our sacrifice be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's church. As we present to you these sacrificial offerings, Lord, for the salvation of your servant Barbara, we ask your love that she may find in you always a merciful judge and a loving, tender, and compassionate brother and in Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. In Christ, the hope of blessed resurrection dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. When this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in heaven. With the angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. And so, Father, we ask you, make holy these gifts brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. On the night before he died for us, he sat at table with those he loved. He took bread and gave you thanks, blessed and broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." At the end of the meal, he took the cup of blessing and gave thanks. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Father, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his coming again, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look upon the offering of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. Let him make us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your apostles and martyrs, with Saint Patrick, Saint Joseph, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant, Francis our Pope, Paul our Bishop, and all the people that you have gained as your own. Hear the prayers of the family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant, Barbara, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the passion, after the pattern of his own glorious body. To all our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ, your Son, our Lord, whom you bestow on all that is good. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let us pray the words Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit. Let us turn and offer to one another a sign of peace. Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are we who are called to the table of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the words, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
So now we will offer our special prayers of commendation for Barbara. But before we do that, let me invite you for a moment of quiet, just to offer God your own thanks for her life, what she meant to you. Offer to God your own prayers and needs of the day, but also that special way of remembering Barbara before the Lord. And then we will bless her one final time. Once more, I will bless her remains with the waters of baptism, which remind us of how we have all been blessed by the grace of God in Christ, and that Christ raises us all into final everlasting life. And I will incense her remains. As the incense smoke rises into the heavens, the Psalms speak of how that fragrant smoke is a reminder of how we enter into the life of God as a fragrance, as something beautiful, as someone holy, as someone to relish.
Thank you.
Now, before our final prayers, just a brief announcement. I want to invite you to join us for a reception. It's in the social hall, which is right below. And so when the singing ends, if you want to go through that door right there, just follow the stairs down 2 flights, and then your nose will lead you towards the food. At least that's how it works for me. So let us stand and conclude our prayers. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Barbara in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, we'll rise with Christ on the last day. Turn toward us, merciful God, and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to us and to your servant, and help us now on earth to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet your Son Jesus, our brother, and see him face to face. Eternal rest grant to her, O Lord, and let perpetual life shine upon her. May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless us, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.